If you're starting a new website for your business, one of the most important decisions you'll make is how to structure it for long-term success. The choice between using a subdomain or a subfolder can significantly affect your site's SEO, user experience, and overall growth potential. Subdomain is a prefix or keyword added before your main domain. For example, if you visit HubSpot's blog, you will see blog.hubspot.com. Or if you check out RankMath's support forum, you will see support.rankmath.com. Now, subdirectory or subfolder is a folder or path added after your main domain. For example, if you visit RankMath's blog, it will be rankmath.com/blog. And when you visit any pieces of content in the blog, it will always start with the blog prefix because all these contents are held in the same folder called blog. Or if you visit LinkedIn Learning, you will see linkedin.com/learning. And if you click on any of its courses, you will see that the course is part of the folder called Learning. Imagine you live in a mansion. Subfolders are like rooms in the main house, the main building, and subdomains are like the guest house, which are separate buildings from the main house, but they all live in the same property, the same land. But the big question is, which is better for your business and how to set it up? Let's talk about that in this video. Let's go. Hey, it's Jack from RankMath, the one SEO plugin that empowers millions of WordPress sites, and this channel is all about helping you grow your search traffic. So if you're new to us, subscribe. Now let's talk about the key differences between subdomains and subfolders. We already know how the URL structure looks like. In terms of SEO treatment, search engines generally treat subdomains as separate entities, but consider subfolders as part of the main domain. In terms of link equity, as in the SEO power that a webpage passes to another through links, there is limited sharing of authority between the subdomain and the main domain, while all the link equity is shared between the main domain and the subfolders. One thing to point out is that even though subfolders are considered as part of the main domain, Google would now evaluate these subsections or subfolders independently to verify if it is different from the main content of the site so that the main domain's ranking signals are not exploited. So if your site gets bigger and opportunities open up, do not create subfolders for third parties to create content on your site to capitalize on your site's reputation. In terms of brand perception, subdomains can make people feel it is a standalone site, but the subfolder may make people feel like an extension of the main site. The setup complexity for subdomain is more challenging as it may require DNS changes, and it is much easier to set up for subfolder through the server or content management system like WordPress. In terms of content management, you could have WordPress running for the main domain and have a different content management system for the subdomain. It is flexible. But for the subfolder, it is inherited by the main domain, which means if the main domain uses WordPress, the subfolders will use WordPress as well. Now for analytics, you may have to create a separate search console and analytics to track the performance of your subdomains. Just to give you context, this is a brand new subdomain, and you will have to connect this subdomain to your search console and analytics to track the performance. You can simply leverage RankMath to make everything seamless. Once you have RankMath installed on your site, hover over it and click on General Settings. From here, you want to click on the Analytics tab. If you have not connected your site with a RankMath account, you will click on this button and follow through the steps. And if you reach this page with a lot of checkboxes, you will want to check all of them for our analytics module to work properly. And don't worry, RankMath will not store any of your data. All the data collected from your search console and analytics will be stored directly on your server. We do not store it on ours. We don't even peep at your data. So if you're given the option to check the services, you want to check them all and click on continue. Give it a while. And now as you can see, your site is now connected to your Google Search Console. Check this out. If you visit the Search Console, as you select a property, you will see that your site has automatically been connected. And if you already have a Google Analytics account, it will be detected here. If you want to create a new property to track your subdomain, you can click on this and a new property will be created. Check this to have RankMath install the analytics code for you. Then this is the privacy of your site visitors. This will speed up your site and this will give you accurate data. Once done, save changes And the next time you want to track your performance of your subdomain, you just have to visit the analytics module and all the data will be available here. This is a brand new subdomain, so there is practically nothing here. And take note that this is just the data of your subdomain. It is separated from the performance of your main domain. Now for the subfolders, the analytics is unified for the entire domain, but you can still segregate your analytics view for different subfolders. For example, assuming we have a lot of content in this recipes subfolder, and you want to track only the performance of the content inside this subfolder. What you can do is to copy the URL path of your subfolder, then go to your Google Search Console, click on this and you want to add a new property. And over here at the URL prefix, you want to paste the URL of your subfolder that ends with a forward slash and click on continue. And that's basically it. You now have a way to segregate your performance tracking. You don't have to further verify your subfolder because the verification has been done on your main domain. So if your website contains a large number of pages under different subfolders, with this segregation, you can easily analyze how each section of your site performs. Now, back to the comparison. In terms of technical overhead, for subdomains, you may need to configure separate hosting environments, SSL certificates, and DNS records. It can be challenging to manage, maintain, and update the subdomains and the main domains separately. But on the flip side, it is generally easier to manage subfolders as everything is in one place. Before we talk about the pros and cons of each entity and when you should use them, let me show you how to get them set up so that you know what you're getting into in terms of the technical setup. Now, if your web host has provided you with access to cPanel or Direct Admin, the process is rather straightforward. Once you are in cPanel, you want to scroll down to look for the domains section and you want to click on domains. From here, you will see your list of domains, but what you want to do is to click on create a new domain. Type in your desired subdomain. For example, in my case, I want to create a support forum for my site. So I will add support.myplugin.shop. Myplugin.shop is the domain. Now, this is the key. If you click on this checkbox, it essentially means that you are hosting all your contents of your subdomain in the same folder as your main domain, which is not what we want. We want to keep them separate, so we will not check this box. And we will hit submit. And here we go. We have created this subdomain. Now, the next thing you want to do is to install a content management system on the subdomain. You can choose whatever platform, but let's say that we want to install WordPress on this subdomain. Let's go back to your cPanel, and then you want to look for a software called Softaculous App Installer. Let's click on this, and then I want to install WordPress. From here, you will choose your subdomain, add some details about your site, add your username, your password, and let's install WordPress on the subdomain. Give it a while, and now WordPress is installed. And when you visit the site, it is a blank WordPress site. And you can install whatever plugins you want for this subdomain because it does not affect your main domain. This will be treated separately from your main domain. As I've mentioned, this process is very easy. All you have to do is to install a simple plugin in WordPress. On your WordPress dashboard, you want to hover over plugins and add a new plugin. Then search for a plugin called Custom Post Type UI, which is right here. Let's install and activate it. Once done, you can now create a subfolder by adding a new post type. Let's say that the content of this subfolder will be book reviews. The slug is basically the name of the subfolder after your domain. So I'll add books in small caps since this will be part of a URL. Let's add the plural label, which is book reviews, and the singular label, which is book review, and add the post type. And we are done. Now, the next time you want to write a book review, you will not create a new post. You would hover over book reviews, which is the custom post type you have created, or in other words, the subfolder, and add a new book review. The new book review will look just like a normal blog post. Let's add a title and save it. Let's publish it. Visit the page, and you will see that this page is part of the subfolder we have just created. Another way is to use the category function that is native to WordPress. But before anything else, we've got to make sure that the proper URL structure is set. We have to hover over settings and click on permalinks. As you can see, I've selected a custom structure to display the category and post name. If you choose to display just the post name, the subfolders or categories will not be displayed. So if you want your subfolder or category to be displayed in your URL, you would use the custom structure with these variables and make sure that you save changes. Once done, you can simply create a new category by hovering over posts and click on categories. From here, you can create a new category. Let's say that we are going to write a lot about SEO, so we can name our category SEO. If we don't add a slug here, it will automatically follow the name of the category. If this category is a subfolder of another subfolder, you will select a parent category. Let's create this category. And we are done. Now let's create a new post. Let's say that this page is about SEO tips. In the post settings, I would select the SEO category. And let's publish this page and visit it. We will see that the URL is domain, followed by the subfolder, and then the page name or post title. And if you want to understand more about permalinks, feel free to check out this video right here. The link is in the description. So when deciding between using subdomains or subfolders, each option offers distinct advantages and challenges, especially in terms of SEO and user experience. Subdomains offer more independence. It allows for different branding, functionality, and targeted content. For example, if your blog decides to set up an online shop to sell things, you could set up shop.domain.com to keep your shop and blog separated. They are also beneficial for separating user-generated content and content for specific regions. For user-generated content like forums or reviews, subdomains prevent potential spam or low-quality links from affecting the main domain's SEO and authority, which is one of the reasons why we have our support forums live on a subdomain. And for region-specific content, subdomains enable businesses to target different geographic audiences with tailored content and SEO strategies, such as having a multilingual site. Plus, you can have a separate rewards.txt file for your subdomain, such as forum.example.com, which is your subdomain, and /robots.txt. While with subfolders, you can't have a separate robots.txt file. With it, you can give instructions to the search engines on what not to crawl on your subdomain. Now, subdomains come with SEO challenges as well. They are treated as separate websites from your main domain by the search engines, meaning backlinks and authority are not shared with the main domain. This can complicate SEO efforts and may confuse users if the browsing experience feels disjointed. Managing multiple subdomains also increases maintenance complexity. Subfolders, on the other hand, consolidate authority and link equity under one domain, providing an SEO boost. They are easier to manage and maintain consistent branding, leading to a smoother user experience. With centralized traffic data, tracking performance is also simplified. However, overusing subfolders can result in complex URL structures, for example, something like this, where the main content is buried under layers of subfolders, which can confuse users, make it hard to navigate, as well as difficulty in crawling and indexing deep pages for the search engines. So when do you use subfolders and when do you use subdomains? Well, if your main concern is cost and management, then you would use subfolders, because for subdomains, on top of the technicalities, you may need to hire more people to oversee the branding, updates and all across all subdomains. If SEO is a primary concern and you prioritize consistent branding, you would use subfolders as well. In terms of international SEO, subdomains are commonly used, but there are ways you could implement proper international SEO with subfolders as well, which we have talked about in this video right here. Feel free to check it out, the link is in the description. Anyway, if you need an environment to do testing, such as a staging environment, you would use subdomains. And if you need separate functionalities for your site, such as creating a shop to sell stuff, creating a forum for user-generated content, creating a demo for your product or service, you would use subdomains. So after hearing all these, what is your preferred option? Let us know in the comments. So with this, I hope you have a clear understanding of the differences between subdomains and subfolders and which is better for your site. They serve different purposes, so I'm not surprised that you would decide to use both. Anyway, if you have any questions or suggestions, feel free to let us know by leaving a comment down below, and don't forget to smash that thumbs up. Our channel is all about helping you grow your search traffic, so if you haven't subscribed to us, consider doing so. This is Jack from RankMath. I'll see you in the next video.